You see that bulldozer over there? The storm dropped that there. I had no idea it was this bad.
Hurricanes are supposed to attack the coastline.
This is actually a farmer's field.
But Bobby Driven tells me she got caught in one.
The road we're driving on.
Nearly washed away as she raced home to check on family in the mountains of Tennessee.
The type of hurricane storm that Florida normally deals with, except it parked right over this area and just dumped rain for a couple of days.
And Appalachia isn't built for this type of weather.
So you can't even see the bridge.
Something like 1 to 2 feet of rainfall.
I don't think anyone truly expected what we saw with Hurricane Helene. Just so widespread. We're talking about multiple counties.
Unless you live in this part of the country, it's kind of hard to grasp what exactly happened here.
It rose in about 4 hours and it left in about two.
People have called it a generational storm, but it wasn't a generational storm. It was a multi-generational storm.
When the flooding suddenly gets so bad, people are dying, and it's washing away houses, even the fire station, and the fire truck, too.
This is where our fire department lost.
Well, you can only imagine how bad the roads are. And a few neighbors so desperate, they decided to build bridges of their own.
Today, we're going to follow one of these highways, US 321, that follows this river here, to show you just how bad things got.
And going inside with the construction crews, who have a pretty big job. The proper permanent repair to these roads to make them look like the storm never happened in the first place.
Oh, man.
When the remnants of Hurricane Helene filled up the Pigeon River,
half the freeway's gone over there.
Interstate 40 really didn't stand a chance.
That's got to be hundreds of feet.
It's fortunate that we didn't have anyone drive through those areas as the roadway was falling away.
Mark Nagy with the Tennessee Department of Transportation tells me contractors have made remarkable progress as they scrambled to help Tennessee and North Carolina get Interstate 40 reopened in just 5 months. Well, partly back open. In March, they got one lane open in each direction.
They have the signs here saying there's a limit on how wide the vehicles can be. Big improvement over the way it was when there were two lanes out of two closed.
Now, rebuilding the other half of the freeway closer to the river, well, that's going to take at least 3 more years. A new mine in a nearby forest will help North Carolina source the 3 million cubic yards of stone they need on their side to build the base to rebuild the freeway on top of.
Of all the messed up roads, I-40 is the one that gets all the attention. Because it's an interstate.
But there's a lot of damage across both states.
At its peak, we had 49 sections of roadways and bridges that were closed across East Tennessee.
I want to look at some of the smaller roads, in particular US 321.
And that takes us to the town of Elk Mills. And this.
It's sort of difficult to imagine a gentle little river like this causing big trouble, but it did.
As the flood of stormwater raced down the mountain, it picked up trees and houses and all kinds of debris.
Was that a van?
That was a tractor trailer.
It all built up and washed the brush up again, two bridges on up here. And as the brush held back the water, built up pressure and knocked that bridge over, then to the next one. And then it came like a tidal wave.
Within hours, all of the bridges residents used to get around became unusable.
Walking around, you just keep finding random pieces of debris. Like this, that's off somebody's building.
And the damage wasn't just on state roads, it was also on local and county roads too. These two bridges serve this peninsula, or at least they did.
So this used to carry Poga Road, or Pogey Road as the locals say.
The damage looks apocalyptic.
I mean, this is just ridiculous. You can see how high up that water got. It washed all the way up to the asphalt and just took everything with it. And this was part of the pavement deck. That's actually asphalt from the road up above. You can see the white line down here.
The victim of all that debris pushing up against the bridge columns.
Yeah, see this big slab of concrete here. I said, oh, okay, this is the driving deck. This is where the cars went. But oh no, it wasn't. This was one of the vertical columns that went up in the air and held the bridge up. The river picked it up and tipped it on its side. You can even see the foundation there where it ripped it right out of the rebar.
And without vertical supports, the horizontal sections fell to the ground.
One thing that kind of bothers me though, I can see one panel of the bridge deck there, and I think that might be a second one down there, but it probably had like 10 of them. So where'd the rest of them go?
But if a community losing one of its bridges was already bad enough.
A few minutes later, the second bridge washed out, making this area they call Bob's Island into an actual island.
And those people were landlocked because the two bridges were out.
And to really reiterate the idea of them being cut off, it was also electricity, which means no pumps for water, telecommunications, which means no cell phones. They were marooned on their own with no bridges.
But within days of the disaster, this social media post started going around, showing a homemade bridge built by Bobby Trivett's dad, Bob.
Bob was the guy who came up with the idea of taking two 18-wheeler trailers. One here and about four down there.
I track Bob down where he works, his store at the top of the mountain, where he drives a tow truck. So, Bob agreed to chat on the move.
Well, we knew we had to do something to get in and out in case somebody on the island got sick or some kind of emergency.
Bob owns an excavator, so he took the bucket and used it to lift it up like a crane, pick up those flatbed trailers, set them down in the river one after another. The whole process to put in the temporary bridge was a community effort.
We just floored it with lumber.
You had people donating those flatbed semi-truck trailers to put into the river.
And to help out with the other bridge that had fallen down.
A guy in Texas.
He built a sis bridge here to go on the other end.
Made out of steel with wooden slats for the driving surface here.
This helped emergency vehicles, utility trucks, and just regular families.
If it wasn't for Bob, nobody would have been able to get off of here.
As rainier weather returned by December, there started to be some problems. But by then, the county was ready to drop a train on them.
Look at the markings here. This looks like it started its life as a train car, and they chopped the wheels off of it.
That's exactly what a company in Tennessee does. Recycle old rail cars and turn them into bridges. This buys Carter County residents some time.
Bob tells me when he spoke with the county to ask how long it would take to get bridges like these rebuilt, they said it might be 8 to 10 years.
Thankfully, back on the state highway, Tennessee is a lot more experienced at getting projects done much more quickly. In fact, construction companies are already working on US 321, including fixing this bridge.
No, it was floating in the air.
This video is not sponsored by self-serve soft drink machines. Broken, so you get a free surprising shower for your hand.
Yeah, there was five sites we had to fix there. Some of them were 90 to 100 foot deep straight off the side of the road.
Scotty Burke is no stranger to a road project. The state of Tennessee hired the company he works for to fix storm-damaged roads all over the region. These sites on US 321, including this, didn't get destroyed, but it definitely has a problem.
So apparently this raging river here will need a pipe that's made out of precast concrete, tall enough that you and I could walk through it.
The storm showed the old drainage pipes were too small and a little too cloggy. And when the water seeps through the soil instead of running through the pipe like it's supposed to, well, that's bad for the dirt and the road on top of it. So to replace the pipe, they had to dig all the way to the bottom of the hill, which is way down there.
Now, this looks like it's missing its highway bridge, but no bridge here. That's all going to be filled back in with different types of earth and soil. The soil is so soggy down there that they're digging all of it up. They're going to haul it up here to this lot, put in better material down there.
Which is an enormous amount of work, one scoop at a time.
See this little toy excavator down here? Well, that's an optical illusion. It's a Cat 374. It's one of the biggest pieces of equipment the company owns.
This Caterpillar has nearly 500 horsepower and can dig down into a hole 28 feet. And thanks to this monster of a machine, the hole is now deep enough to lay out the new pipes. And then they get to do it all in reverse, fill that hillside back in with good soil, so they can get this detour reopened, which has affected more than a few neighborhoods. But the big damage is still at the heart of town.
This concrete pad is all that's left of Elk Mills Fire Station. The river picked the building up and washed it under the bridge over there.
Which is obviously bad for the fire station, but it's also not good for the bridge either.
Its equipment, the building and fire truck, and deposited it in Watauga Lake.
And it washed their tanker truck to right here.
And the irony's not lost on us that water took out a fire truck. Thankfully, another fire department heard the news, so they donated one of their old pumper trucks.
Elk Mills had a general store, and it used to be right over there. But after it got buried in 4 to 5 feet of water and debris, it was so messed up they had to knock that building down. Over here was their warehouse. They're now using that as a general store instead, at least temporarily.
As the water pushed trees and vehicles and buildings underneath this bridge, it took a shortcut, cut the corner off, and that sent water places it wasn't supposed to go, which is a problem all along the river. But in the case of this bridge, the flooding almost washed out one of its foundations.
It's undermining the buttress of the bridge.
All the water and the debris flow, it hit the west side of this bridge really hard, washed out everything underneath this abutment. Then lucky the whole bridge didn't fall down.
So how do you fix a floating bridge?
We actually had to set some forms on the outside, core holes in the top of it, pump flow fill, from the top down into there so it'd have an air breather to let the concrete come all the way up to the top. Pull our forms out and then rip wrap all the way back around the bridge.
Rip wrap's the nickname for these big stones. Water easily washes away dirt, but big rocks, those stay put no matter how wet they get.
Something a geotechnical engineer would call armoring.
You've seen this along rivers and lakes, where big riprap rocks keep the dirt from washing away. And this kind of armoring should help protect this bridge from a, heaven help us, second flood. As you keep driving north, the river ate the highway.
Say this road from the yellow line this way was completely gone.
Kind of like a miniature version of what happened to Interstate 40. Left with half a road that was unstable to drive on, Highway 321 was closed.
Three quarters of a lane on that side that you could drive, which the locals had come through here already and trimmed them out of trail.
Storm or not, when water and soil get into a fight, water wins.
The thing that causes most of this are the swirls. If you get back to where the water actually hits into the bank, it creates an eddy, like a swirl, and that's what just slowly eats away at the bank, and then it just works its way on down.
So this is really neat. A geotechnical engineer would call this an MSE wall for mechanically stabilized earth. Scotty calls it Ready Rock. That's a brand name of an MSE wall. But basically, you have these blocks that you stack on top of each other, but what holds them in place is the dirt on the other side of the wall.
A company trucks in concrete blocks, precast in a factory. And once they've hauled them onto the site, they start stacking them like Legos.
It has a grid that runs plumb through it, interlocks it in, and you put stone in behind it to hold the grid down, which holds the wall from falling.
The grid hooks into each block. You bury it, and all that force pushing down on the grid keeps the grid from sliding back and forth, which keeps the block wall from wanting to fall over, which holds the soil in place.
Comes up through the block and then around again, and then you'll layer rock on top of grid, rock on top of grid until you get to the top. Every length was different depending on how tall the wall was. So if you had a 10-foot tall wall, I think you had to be 75%. Further you get up, obviously the less weight you got to hold back, so they could shorten up some there.
This type of work is specialty enough that bakers didn't do it themselves. They hired it out. But Scotty's pretty happy with how it turned out.
Judy Walls is the name of them. They're out of Kentucky. They were probably some of the best subcontractors we've used.
Okay, so if you don't want your road project to squish down, you want to excavate all the way down to the bedrock and then build back up. And that's what the geotechnical engineers ask for on projects like these. And the first thing they're going to tell crews to do is to bring in this stuff.
And every single truck that brought it had to shift into reverse.
All the way from the very end of this road, all the way back.
This video is viewer funded. That means no financial relationship with any sources, including Baker's Construction, the state of Tennessee, or self-serve soda machines. You don't want to build your road on top of weak mud or, you know, water. You want something solid.
Solid rock.
Yeah, the bigger rock is going to hold a better foundation.
Huge, choppy pieces of rock that interlock with each other. They're not going anywhere. And this stuff's great because you can drive a big truck on it. But also, when it rains, it's not going to start washing away. There's huge gaps in between this GSR for the water to freely move downward and get out of the project. Trouble is, I can't now come in with paving equipment and pour asphalt on top of this because it's way too bumpy. So I have to work my way down to smaller pieces of rock, stuff, you know, maybe more like this size. And the problem is, if I bring a truckload of this stuff in and start pouring it in, it's just gonna go right into the voids and fill those voids up.
Because you're gonna put road base on it. You don't want your road base filtering down through the bigger rock. You don't want it to fall into those voids.
So you put a slightly smaller rock on top, and then a slightly smaller rock on top of that, and smaller to the point where you have sand.
It's kind of like putting marbles in a cup. Put your marbles in, you still got all that room. You throw a little rice in, still got all that room. Throw a little sand in, still got room. You can pour water in it.
But to really make sure the medium-sized rocks don't fall down with the big ones, they use this grid. To keep the small ones out,
they'll actually put down a big piece of fabric.
They come on hilariously large rolls, which is fun to watch them drag it into place.
And eventually, you work your way up to the top layer of the cake, so to speak. Select backfill, real small pieces of rock that go on top.
And the hundreds of dump trucks that had to come in here, well, they had to deal with the broken road, too.
All our trucks had to back in the whole time. And there was no room to build a turnaround without getting into the lake, and they frown upon stuff like that.
One of the challenges with a highway project is dirt's not the same. It's different wherever you go. Geotechnical engineers actually dig holes, little sample cores, about every 100 to 1,000 feet or so, go down 10 feet below the road to see what kind of dirt is there. they'll actually take this big like 140-pound hammer machine and start squishing the dirt to see how squishy it is, if it's strong enough to hold the road or if they're gonna have to dig it all out and replace it. Water content's another issue too. So if you have soil that doesn't have a lot of water in it, like off the top here, it's all crumbly, it has no strength, it'll just wanna slide off the hillside. But if you start having just enough water in it, they call that the plastic limit, it'll actually get kind of almost like, well, like cake mix when you add just the right amount, right? And it starts to turn into kind of almost like a dirt snowball here. That's pretty strong. This whole hillside has enough water in it to keep the hillside from sliding down. But what happens if I add too much water to it? Well, I now cross the liquid limit, and then this whole thing turns into a dirt milkshake and washes away. And as you can imagine, during the storm, that happened.
You may notice we haven't really talked about rebuilding the roads much at all. Geotechnical engineering is the quiet hero. Every civil engineering project sits on top of soil, an engineering discipline critical to getting this highway back open.
The locals here didn't have any source, fire, EMS. It was like an hour and a half round trip to go the long way around.
Just getting one lane back open has been a big help.
Three or four times we've had to move all of our stuff out of the way, give them access to get through, let them get the person and get them out of here. I think one time it was a heart attack victim. The emergency people came back and told us, had we not been able to get out of the way and let them get back through there, that guy probably would have passed on.
Probably my biggest takeaway from this whole thing, this community is incredible. It's filled with just the most amazing people.
It's a testimony to our TDOT folks, our contractors, working so many hours.
It's cool to say you helped rebuild something that's been here for 60, 80, 100 years. It would be cooler to be around in 80 to 100 years and see it still here.
It's pretty humbling that little old water here can do a lot of damage when it wants to. And I had no idea until I got out here just how big this disaster was. Probably because it's not affecting a lot of people, but that doesn't mean that it isn't affecting those people a lot. I'll see you next time.
A huge thank you to Mark at TDOT and Scotty at Baker's, as well as the Trivet family. And off camera, thanks to Michael Bridges, the geotech engineer, Patrick Black at Baker's, who shot a lot of that fun footage, and he's the one who talked me into driving all the way across the country for this story. And you are the one who paid for me to go there. Thanks for helping me tell this story instead of standing in front of a green screen.